Welcome to the Chapel Roswell Games. This is a two-week series honoring the Olympics. And of course, as we all know, the Olympics got started with the opening ceremonies on Friday. Do not tell me what happened in the opening ceremonies, please. I'm only 2.5 hours into my 6-hour recording. I don't want to know how it ends yet. In preparation for our two-week theme of the Olympics, I have been doing a little reading, maybe a little deep diving on some of the history of the ancient games, and that's what's made me love the opening ceremonies. Because all of these random things I've been reading and learning, they've been putting little bits of the history in the opening games. So if you watch the games, if you've watched any of the sports or commentary so far, you know that part of what we do in the games is we always add new sports. That's just what we do. We add new things. And so did you know that we have a new sport? You know this potentially. We have a brand new sport in our summer games. Does anybody know what it is? Thank you. Yes, it's breakdancing. I love this. I am thrilled that we have breakdancing as a part of the games. Jarrett, our business administrator, our newest clergy appointed to the church, he preached 2 weeks ago on dancing and spontaneous dance parties. I think he was preparing the way for a spontaneous breakdance party. So I have to ask, are there any breakers here? And would those breakers like to come give me an example? Come on, right here. Let's see the breakdancing. I am very surprised. Let's do it. Nice. Very nice. You win. Nicely done. Let's do it. Show me. You got this. Nice. Nice. Very nice. You too have won an Olympic medal today. Very nice. Thank you very much. That was awesome. Does anyone know the old... Oh, come on. I'm not going to skip you. Go for it. Lovely. Yes. Girls rule. Very nice. Lovely. Thank you. Good job. That was awesome. Does anybody know the oldest sport of the Olympics? The oldest sport. It is not a trick question. Kind of. It's called the foot race. Marathon would not come into play until the Olympics resurged in the 1800s. Dating back to 776 before this common era, before the time of Christ, we have proof of the first Olympic game where people were foot racing. It was a run of about 600 feet. And the athletes who would come and do this foot run, they were men. We also know, I read, that the men, these athletes who would come to the place to compete in these Olympics, as soon as they got there, they would take all their clothes off. And they would train and they would compete without any clothes on. Yes, what you said. It was supposed to be this symbol of this harmony, this perfect balance between mind and body. I too think it sounds very uncomfortable, but I am not an Olympian. One of the other things I learned is where these athletes came from. These athletes were from city-states. There were 4 different city-states that would compete against one another. But the problem is, these city-states lived at war. They were constantly fighting. So every 4th year, or every Olympiad, as they were called, these city-states would call a truce, so that the athletes could move to the host city-state safely. One historian I read called this the perfect moment of peace. Another historian I read called it the perfect example of civility. Another historian, kind of a rogue guy, I think, he said it looked great on paper, but he's thinking one or two people may have gotten hurt along the way. I think we all understand what fighting is like because we do it all the time. We fight constantly. There's so much to fight over. We fight over who's going to run for president and who's not going to run for president. We fight over who we're going to vote for and who we're not going to vote for. We fight over nations. We fight over church. We fight over marriage. We fight over reproductive rights. We fight over health care. We fight over everything. And even as this little area, the city, we fight over street closures and historic buildings. We don't just disagree with one another. We have huge conflicts, and those conflicts turn into war that do not allow us to pass safely from conversation to conversation. As I was learning about the Olympics, as I was deep diving, I began to ask myself a question that I have never asked myself before. I asked myself, okay, did Jesus go to the Olympics? Did Jesus know about the Olympics? Did Jesus know an athlete? Did Jesus know somebody who went to the Olympics? Well, guess what? There's absolutely no proof of it. There's absolutely no proof that Jesus even knew about the Olympics or went to the Olympics. But I'm here to say, after all my extensive online research, I'm going to say yes. Yes, Jesus very much knew about the Olympics because I already told you. It started in 776 before the Common Era, and it didn't even end until the 4th century after his birth. And so I'm going to say absolutely the Olympics were alive and well during the lifetime of Jesus. And if you do the math, it probably happened 7 or 8 times during the lifetime of Jesus. And while there's no real proof he went or he knew about it, there is scriptural proof that someone else did. We have proof in scripture that we know someone who lived in one of those city-states. We know that that city-state also hosted the Olympics. The city-state, of course, is Corinth. The person I'm talking about is Paul, right? We know that Paul knew about the Olympics because he lived and related to the people who hosted the games. When you were an athlete in the Olympics, and when you ran your foot race, you were running to win so they would put a beautiful wreath upon your head. And depending upon which city-state Olympics you won was dependent upon what was made, what the wreath was made of. In the city of Corinth, if you won the Olympics, then they placed a wreath of pine on your head. You may recall words from a book called Corinthians, where Paul says, "Do not run your foot race for the reward of the wreath they will put on your head, but run your foot race for the one reward of the one heaven and the one God." That is proof. The other thing Paul would have known is that the Olympics were actually kind of a divine affair. It was meant to honor those gods and goddesses of the day because it was believed that the one athlete was divinely selected by the goddess of Nike herself. And so in preparation for all of the games, In training of the races, the city-states would erect temples and monuments and make sacrifices to Zeus, the creator, to Poseidon over the waters, to all of the minor and major gods to say, select our athlete to win it all. And so it is in this context, this polytheistic world and culture of the games that Paul is writing in, which gives us a new idea, a new sense of sight, and a new way to hear the words of all of his letters. In particular, what he wrote to the people in Ephesus, the Ephesians. Ephesians 4 says this, I therefore, the prisoner in the Lord, beg you to walk in a manner worthy of the calling to which you have been called, with all humility and gentleness, with patience, bearing with one another in love, making every effort to maintain the unity of the Spirit in the bond of peace. There is one body and one Spirit, just as you were called to be the one hope of your calling, one Lord, one faith, one baptism, one God and Father of all, who is above all and through all and in all. But each of us was given grace according to the measure of Christ's gift. Therefore, it is said, when he ascended on high, he made captivity itself a captive. He gave gifts, talents, skills to his people. When it says he ascended, by the way, what does it mean but that he also descended into the lower parts of the earth? He who descended is the same one who ascended far above all the heavens so that he might fill all things. He himself granted that some are apostles, some are prophets, some evangelists, pastors and teachers to equip the saints for the work of ministry, for the building up of the body of Christ until all of us come to the unity of the faith and the knowledge of the Son of God to maturity, to the measure of the full stature of Christ. And so we must no longer be children, tossed to and fro and blown about by every wind of every doctrine, by people's trickery, by their craftiness and deceitful scheming, but speaking the truth in love. We must grow up in every way into him who is the head, into Christ, from whom the whole body, joined and knit together by every ligament into which it is equipped, as each part is working properly, promotes the body's growth in building itself up in love. So there is one body, there is one God, there is one faith, there is one baptism, there is one Lord. For Paul, the whole central theme of all of his writing is unity. And it is from this one umbrella, this one God, that we can have apostles and teachers and pastors and evangelists and gymnasts and breakers and basketball players and surfers and everyone. It is all of the different skills and talents and gifts that each of us have in our own diversity that come from the same one God. And so it's a reminder of the unity that we need to build the body of Christ. So what does it mean to build up the body of Christ? It means that we are not rigid. It means that we're dynamic. It means that we're moving. It means that the church is constantly changing and evolving and adapting. It means that we honor the ministries that we've been given. We honor all of our traditions and our scripture while adding to it. Say it in a different way, it means that we know as a body of Christ that we have been trained, but we are constantly training. Last year in 2023, the United Nations met to talk about the Olympics. And this is what the speech, part of the speech says, "The Olympic Village, where thousands of athletes from all over the world live together peacefully. It is the most symbolic representation of the universality of the games. It's a place where, whether you're, whatever your nationality, whatever your gender, whatever your skin color, you can come and live here in harmony, respecting others and receiving respect. The village is united in one place in its all diversity. Like the United Nations General Assembly, of which you are all worthy representatives, the village and its athletes help to show that the better world is possible. And so we bring you a strong message, a universal message in favor of peace, according to the ancient Greek tradition of the Olympic truce." It goes on to say, "I stand before you humbled by the course of the world events, but also with a deep conviction that more than ever, sport has a role to play and can help us take a step toward a more unified world." Technically speaking, whether you knew it or not, the United Nations adopted the Olympic truce. And so technically speaking, right now, we are living in perfect peace and civility. But like the historian said, it looks good on paper, but I'm afraid one or two of us are still getting hurt. I think that happened probably in Paul's lifetime too, because that's what Paul says, do not be blown to and fro from one doctrine, from one belief, just because it provides a moment or provides something popular or there's something that looks easy. Quit making sacrifices to all the wrong things. Quit building temples to all the wrong things. Because strength is found in the one God, the Creator, the one God of the water of baptism, and the one God of victory. I am not an athlete. I'm not an Olympian. My body is not as strong as it should be. I know you're shocked. But I know what strength looks like. And to many Olympians, to many athletes, this is an example of strength.
So we're going to do a rope challenge, gymnast versus NFL player.
Okay.
And the bet was, what was the bet?
Would I get a foot massage, 30 minutes?
No, you said 50 bucks.
Oh, $50, okay, okay.
Ready, set, go.
About three-fourths of the way, I burned out.
Of course, it's Simone Biles, our gymnast, who actually challenged her husband, the NFL player, to the challenge. She won. Girls rule. We all know this. It's a wonderful video. I love it. It is a great example of strength. But to some of us, strength looks like this. 1992, Derek Redmond tore his hamstring, and it was the strength of his father that made sure he finished the race, not on the stretchers, but across the finish line. Anne Lamott writes a great book called Traveling Mercies, and in it she talks about why she made her son go to church. She said that she was going through to a church called St. Andrew's, and whenever she was at the end of her rope, the people of St. Andrew's tied a knot at the end to help her hold on. There are people around us who need to be carried. There are people around us that need to be reminded they're strong. There are people around us who need training. And there are people around us who need a truce. How do we build up the body of Christ? We tie as many knots as we can. Amen. Pray with me. Holy and gracious Lord, I ask you now to draw us together. Like the different ligaments of a body, help us to work together and move in unity for you. Give us a sense of humility, a sense of gentleness, and a sense of patience, so that while we may not agree, we can live together. Help us to have one goal, and the goal is to honor you in all that we do. And so, if there are times when we have not respected, or we have not honored, or we have not heard, forgive us. And may we begin to keep you closer to us so that we can recognize it. Put in our ways a new opportunity or a new race or a new competitor or a new friend. Put people in front of us to challenge us to be better and to help us be more like you and to strengthen our sense of discipline. Help us to see you in all things so that we can develop a new depth of trust with you. Help us too to make decisions based on your victory and not ours. And help us not to build things that do not honor you, but put in us a new and right spirit so we may live lives that are worthy and that are good. And Lord, we do pray for the many people who are even thinking about school. As students try to navigate software and back ways to learn schedules and teachers and who's in classrooms, all the class lists, be in all of it. Be with teachers, be with faculty, be with staff, be with maintenance, as everyone is preparing a room to receive people. And bless each of those classrooms already. And give teachers an extra dose of confidence and courage and patience. And give students an extra dose of confidence and courage and patience too. And Lord, for anything that comes this week, may we make sure that you are our priority and that we're always open to a new sport in front of us. Amen.